Well, it started out down a dirty road. Started out all alone. I'm learning to fly, but I ain't got wings. Coming down is the hardest thing.
And we ended that video with a very smiling Manny Franco aboard Tis the Law, who's 3 days out from running in the Belmont Stakes up in the Big Apple. As we gaze out, a live shot, everybody, at about 11:05 a.m. on this Wednesday, June the 17th. Sunny and a tad sultry here at Gulfstream Park, but a new week begins. We're happy about that. And you just can't argue with the weather, the run of recent weather we've had here at Hallandale Beach. Hello again, everyone, from outside to inside. Jason Blewett joining all of you. And a hearty good morning on this, again, Wednesday edition of Gulfstream Park today. We're back at it. We've got a 10-race card coming down the pike. Some dough, money in the jackpot Rainbow Six. And a situation where as we go forward, we've got to bring in the man downstairs holding the fort right outside the paddock, the one and only Ron Nicoletti. How's it going, buddy?
It's going good. And as you mentioned, I like that word sultry. That's exactly what it is today, but there's nothing better than having a fast main track and lots of turf racing.
Absolutely. We do actually begin on the turf with a start time of about 12:05 Eastern and a very competitive lower-level maiden claimer to start the proceedings on this Wednesday, June the 17th. Money in the jackpot Rainbow Six. We capped things here this past Sunday with the 100K guarantee. We will up the ante, my friend, putting in an additional $100,000 this afternoon.
Yeah, we just keep raising it up. Let's see before it hits 2 million again. It seems like it'll be a week away.
Absolutely. Looking at the situation at hand this afternoon on this Fast and Firm Wednesday, Ronnie, we'll dive in. I got lucky here for a change on a Sunday, connected with the good price long shot winner in the first, and somehow was able to string 4 consecutive winners after that horse and give it some welly. I'm back at it today, hoping to build off of hopefully some positive momentum with a 3-horse spread in a very competitive first race where I don't know who's going to be favored here, but my one real opinion of the race. I'm not a big fan of the 5 couple of Dickies, and I'll elaborate as to why that's the case in just a few seconds. Do have my eye on a price who I didn't pick, but the 4 De Dupe has a pedigree to me that just strikes turf, and more turf, and she's my price play. I included her as one of three I have in that 2-4-7 spread. A number of scratches in the second race, but what I like about that lower-level maiden claimer for 2-year-old fillies is the fact you've got 3 interesting-looking second-time starters who have all found their way onto this early pick 5 ticket, a play, I should say, Ronnie, that was very much built, maybe somewhat fittingly, around the French-bred aficionado in our upcoming third race, because that filly who's in for $30,000 claiming, she strikes me as a little bit of an all-or-nothing type horse who's either going to win or perhaps just not hit the board, but I opted to single her. I think she's going to run well.
Yeah, I did not use her, as on top of my ticket, but a good ticket you put together for $27. Hey, you're going for 2 in a row for the early pick 5. I got to like that.
Yep, aficionado, my building block, hopefully single and winning single at that in the third race, as we have a familiar scene opener a little afternoon with a good-sized chunky field on the turf in this 3-and-up Philly Amare 12-5 to 10-5 maiden claimer. The 3 that I've got boxed up in my try are all pretty diverse on paper, and that's one of the things I like about this race. Now, you and I both picked the Todd Pletcher second-time starter, Ronnie, the 7, Millefiori, who's just, I think she's going to improve this afternoon, and she's going to get bet in this spot for Todd.
Yeah, she's dropping to the 12-5 level. They're going to put blinkers on her this afternoon. She failed to show much in her $25,000 career debut. That was going a mile on the turf. It was during April, but we've seen this numerous times with Todd Pletcher. He drops and puts them in the right spot, and they improve. Even though the running line in the first race might be a little ugly, they come back and they run well. Edgard's eye is handling that drop down today.
Moving away from her, as we both like her for the W and think she'll improve in for the the 12-5 in her second start. What she's got going for her, theoretically, is the fact that she's only run the one time. And then when you start to pick apart some of the other major players on paper, I had questions with just about all of them. Now, I prefer my first ex-wife, the Deuce, a little more than you do. I've got her second. You've got her third. She's got, in a way, maybe the most consistent and best-looking turf form. You just don't know, is she going to be able to route and stay a distance around two turns? I do find it interesting that her previous trainer, Jorge Abreu, never tried her around two turns, even though she was losing one of those turf sprints, one after another at a short price. And then we have the three, Matka, who's now with trainer Kent Sweezy, as she looks to pick things up off respectable but also lackluster recent form for previous trainer John Kimmel.
Yeah, now in Kent's barn, Mayor Wilsbach, she responded to the class relief last time out with that second place finish at this level and distance. The new connections, they got Sammy Camacho in the saddle. I thought these were the logical three, and I know the five horse was the morning line favorite, is actually favored now. I got that one further down on my ticket.
She's just had so many chances, and I get this might be, on the positive side, a new ball game running for 12-5, but her last couple, at least to me, just don't do it for me, and I'm going to sit this one out. You've got her fourth, so you're very much sharing the same sentiment, Ronnie, as I have in that first race. As we get on to the second, I think the narrative off the bat, and we'll head to the main track for the first time, is very much about three second-time starters who I think, unsurprisingly, Ronnie, you boxed up, as did I. We took them in different orders, but that's what I like about this race. You've got the three second-out geldings and colts who are representing two last-out fields here at Gulfstream Park, one on May 1st, the other back on May 28th. Let's show you the May 1st race off the bat, beginning with my top pick, the number five, Chucky. And I pulled the start because I wanted to show just how alert this Arundel homebred was from the rail, how just quickly and nimbly he was out of the gate, and really no knocks against him at this point. He wasn't able to keep up with the Wesley Ward Firster, lucky as a seven, who just sped off as the 4-5 favorite. But I think this horse's early speed might be more effective or more powerful than it looks. And here's more or less the head-on. He was out of the race, and nobody really gained anything, but you can really see a horse who was quite green in that final furlong, give or take, and I think he is very much a candidate to move forward. And don't sleep on him as a potential wire-to-wire winner in this race, because he was out of the gate like that and just couldn't keep up early, I think, against a better field in his debut.
Yeah, listed as a gelding, he makes his first start since that race you showed. He was fourth. That was his 4.5 furlong debut back on May 1st. The Juan Alvarado had an excellent spring so far with his two-year-old runners. You got Joseph Trejos, the apprentice, atop this son of brethren. But I did go with the 10 Fun Loaded. We'll get to that one before we show you Heavenly Blessing, who I have in second. Fun Loaded is stretching out to 5/8 of a mile. Promising 4.5 furlong debut. He showed some speed. He faded to finish fifth. But I got a stat on Ralph Nix, why I put this horse on top. You know, Ralph Nix with his two-year-old second start, maiden claimers on the dirt. He's 10 for 30. 33%. He's in the money 67% of the time. 1.5 always return of investment. Fun Loaded on top. I'm using Chucky, and just like you're using the 8 Heavenly Blessing.
And Ronnie, you obviously, in the rematch between your top pick Fun Loaded and the 8 Heavenly Blessing, you prefer that horse to get the better of Heavenly Blessing, because they come out of the same field here. In fact, prior to scratches, we had a quartet, 3rd through 6th, coming out of this race. And why don't we backtrack and we can look at Heavenly Blessing. I thought, for me anyway, that this horse ran a fine race. And from an educational standpoint, this is a horse that, like Chucky, is going to move forward. Now, it's easy to quarterback from up here in the studio, but if you make that move and you gun, you better get up in there. And Jockey decided to hit basically the brakes and the eject button, and this horse got shuffled back after not being able to outfoot the number five horse in Mamba on 3. You'll watch, though, to her credit, or to his credit in this spot, this first-time starting colt was able to get back up into the race, angled out, was pretty green there. This was a solid building block debut, Ronnie, where I think just in the span of about 50 seconds, he had a lot thrown his way in a short amount of time.
Yeah, you know, that's why I wouldn't leave him off the ticket. I got him in second. I just thought with the, you know, Ralph's record of improving horses in their second start, I flip-flopped him.
We'll move on to the third this afternoon. We are on the turf course going a route of ground, going a mile, in fact, with this three-year-old filly, 30, down to $20,000 claimer. This has been a condition, I feel like, for the last couple of months, looking at the Days of Springs of the world, the La Russias of the world. I just have not been able to really race after race. I haven't been able to get a good grip on them. And for better or for worse, I'm just going to take a new face here. And she's got a lot to prove. And I don't ultimately love the fact that Aficionado, after getting bet so strongly first out in this country for Patrick Biancone, is all of a sudden in for a $30,000 claiming race. Can she go around a ground? I don't know, but I would like to think in a spot like this, she's going to run, even though she's got some gray areas to step up and answer this afternoon, and I'm just going to take her for a couple of guys, and Patrick Biancone and Luca Panici, Ronnie, who are 3 days out from taking on Tis the Law in the Belmont Stakes.
Yeah, the excellent conditions there. You know, I backed off this horse. I don't know if I didn't give it enough respect, but I did go with the La Russia, who's run well against this caliber competition on the turf, is going back to the grass, finished fourth against those 25 optional claimers. That was on that sealed sloppy track. She stakes play. She's a daughter of Hampton Court. I think she looks strong for the $30,000 tag. That was my thought process. I think she needed this drop.
And we both obviously like the 60 ender.
Yeah, definitely. Fifth behind La Russia when they competed at the 50 level in April, was sent to the sidelines. It's Mark Cassie, and I think the drop down also helps this daughter of Cantheros.
Let's move on to the fourth. 1 mile the distance here, back on the main. This is a very tricky race, and you do have quite a bit of respectable maiden form in the camp of the two independent miss, and I think most importantly, the number four, Estilo Talentoso. I worry, I really wonder and question if 8 furlongs is a bit of a tricky setup for both of these fillies, even though I think they easily own the best form in this field to date. I wonder, Ronnie, for me, if both of them can stay a 1 mile distance. I really think they might be vulnerable at crunch time, and I took a wise guy horse in this race, the 5 May Eye. I had landed on a first-time J.C. Avila trainer change here on Sunday, who went off far shorter, around 6-1 or so at El Gran Cacao, who looked impossible on paper, got bet, and didn't run. And I'm right back with a filly by FedBiz. Who knows where she stands on the dirt? But I'd like to think not only is she a second-time starter, she's first-time JC, and her recent work tab here at Gulfstream on the main, it looks decent to me. A bunch of crisp half miles and 47. I'm going to try her at a race where, again, I respect the 4 and 2. I just worry about both of those horses staying a mile.
Well, Estilio Talentoso, well, he's the number four, we'll call it, is getting the blinkers removed after only that one start, which I like. Following that quartet of second place finishes, sprinting, comes back, set the pace, drifts third when trying the mile with the shades added last time out. I like that Juan Arrigot is taking off the blinkers. Sammy Camacho trying to prove. Definitely has also ran status with 5 starts, 4 wins, and a second independent miss, and then Ever Smart. I'm going to go back and look at your 5 horse.
Yeah, there's not much to look at, Ronnie. I mean, she's second out. She's a first-time J.C. Avila, and could be a good spot, maybe a opportunistic spot where she could take advantage of a couple of horses, again, who have just run pretty well. But I just wonder if one of them's going to deliver the knockout punch at what I think is a pretty demanding one-turn setup going 8 furlongs this afternoon. As we take a little breather here on the broadcast, back with the Rainbow Six after this. Wednesday of Belmont Week here in South Florida at Gulfstream Park, and things were quite active this morning. I arrived at about 9:25, 9:30. There were a bevy of horses jogging fairly late during training hours, but things have obviously settled down outside, and that live shot vista high above the finish line here, a few stories up in the sky here with that pan camera at Gulfstream Park. As once again, we move outside to inside, Ronnie and Jason, glad to have you with us, everybody. Second segment, act number two here on Gulfstream today. And we are racing here this afternoon, of course. We're dark tomorrow, but on Friday, Ronnie, not only, I guess, in a way, the eve of the Belmont Stakes, but the Florida Derby winner, a clear favorite, we bring on another round of the Stronach 5.
Yeah, the Stronach 5. We've got two races in it. We're going to do our eighth and ninth race. We're actually kicking it off here at Gulfstream Park with our eighth race of the afternoon. We also have our finale in there and a couple of races from Laurel, and we're ending it with our sister track, Santa Anita, at about 5 p.m. So paid very nice last week, $17,000, but you could say that every week.
$200K, the guarantee in the Rainbow Six. You're going to take a little stab at it this afternoon. What are you doing?
I got a 43.20 cent ticket today, and it is a tough sequence. I did go three deep in here with the 5 September 10, Flaming Hot and Handsome Prince, and three deep again in race number 6. Boy, that's a tough race with Elite Appeal, Karenina, and El Scocho in there. And then I went two deep. I think that the Take Charge Again, looks good with Palace. Two-step, three deep in race number 8, another wide-open race. I got my long shot in there, Bahamian Prince, 12-1 on the morning line. First off the claim for Gustavo Delgado, and two deep in race number 9 with the 3, Indimage, and the 8, Tis Approved. And I'm closing it with 2, with Sydney's Treasure, Larry Ravelli thinks the one to beat. I also use New York Commander, 43.20 for me, very, very tough sequence.
And things are not easy or cut and dried as we start the sequence at about 205, 210 Eastern as the Rainbow Six gears up with the 7 furlong, 2 lifetime, $25,000 claimer. Think you and I landed on the same horse here because we were discussing this race on Sunday, late Sunday afternoon. We both like the 5 September 10, who I look at in a spot like this. I am almost treating him as a first time, 2 lifetime in for a quarter. Gave him a major excuse for the wet track last time out.
Yeah, stretching out to the 7 furlongs after those back-to-back fourth-place finishes. I believe that was against better. That was going 3 quarters. I think Rohan Crichton, the trainer, finds a perfect spot. Non-winners of 2 lifetime for the elusive career, second career victory. Edgard's going to get the mount this afternoon, and I use Flaming Hot, I said, on my ticket, along with Handsome Prince. We similar have the similar super that we boxed together.
Absolutely. The number 3, Quick Step Ed, is a first time in for at least a claiming tag. He had debuted for Maiden 35 for John Vincent. I just, with him coming off a layoff that dates back to mid-April, I just got to think he runs far better and is just far more impactful and effective than he was in that allowance debut. I like the 2 new faces. Again, my major hook of the race is just that September 10 did not like that sloppy sealed track last time out. We'll see. Here's the 6th race on the card. We're back on the turf. We'll chase that late pick 5 at a very difficult. I found this 6th race a wickedly difficult race. I've got major issues with the top 2 morning line choices, or 2 horses that are going to get bet and are fairly short on the morning line, and didn't know what to do there. So I've got a 4-horse spread to start. Played it pretty safe, I think, the remainder of the way with the 5 Take Charge Again, and just off a September 10 comment with the sloppy sealed track, I'm hoping the 10 Ma Meatloaf in race number 7 just maybe needed that race at Gulfstream and perhaps didn't care for the sloppy sealed track last time out. 8th race is, in a way, I think the toughest race on today's card. There is a very important, bulky 4-horse rematch off a blanket finish turf race here on May the 8th, and some new shooters sprinkled in like the 6 Uncorked the Bottle. Anchored this play, this late pick 5 play, around the rail dropping number 1 Ice T, who I was really, really, really worried about his inside post, smack dab inside of the 2 Create Again. Just in terms of pace, it's a moot point now because Create Again scratched. I think that is a massive scratch to help out Ice-T, a major assist in the pace department, and hopefully he can wire the field. And I'll wrap things up with the 2-horse spread for $24. Looking at this 4-horse spread, Ronnie, that I have to start Wednesday's late pick 5, Karenina, the 11, always gets bet for the most part. She hasn't been favored in quite some time, but you've got her second. She's 1-for-30. Is that a concern of yours going in?
Yeah, I wrote in my analysis today, however, that the record that you just alluded to is a concern for the otherwise hard-trying mare. She always tries. That's why I put the 7, who you have on top, elite appeal on top, knocking on the door in the turf against it. I thought enough. Notch tougher before the layoff is back in the grass. Returned from that couple of month layoff to, to finish the Presta Pace fourth against those two lifetime claimers. That was going a mile on the main track. I like this one on the turf. Karenina, you know, it's for my exacta play in here. And then I used the horse you have in second, El Scorcho, in third.
El Scorcho, who's coming up at trying winners for the first time. I don't necessarily like Maka in the first race, but I mean, El Scorcho buried her last time out, and she's only run three times. So not only did she win convincingly in a spot she should have won, there might be a little more in the tank as she makes her fourth lifetime start for trainer John Service. And then that brings us to the Bob Hess claim in Caribbean Kitten. We'll backtrack to her last start here in the fourth race on May 7th. She ran great. I mean, in context of a maiden 16, both her and that horse immediately off her flank with the black cap and the white striped sleeves and the big white blaze, Garner State Park, they'll pull away from this race. And I mean, look at their odds. I mean, Caribbean Kitten was 8-5 and Garner State Park wasn't that short, actually, at 3-1. I do wonder, though, and I think it's a real issue, and it's not a knock on her current connections. I just, you know, you're claiming a turf horse off Mike Maker, who needed a drop to maiden 16 to get it done. Where do you go out of the claim box, off that hard-fought win? Does she run another big race this afternoon as she dips down slightly as far as the claim price is concerned?
Yeah, that was the concern, and both of us have a little further down the ticket for that reason. You know, I just think that she'd have to run better, and we'll see. Maybe she can do it. Like you said, that this race, like the eighth in my estimation, both of them pretty tough.
Yep, absolutely. Now, the seventh race this afternoon is a race that, as I was saying with my late pick five, I played this race pretty straight. I mean, clearly the recent form of the five Take Charge Again just paints her as a major player and major contender. And if you're willing to draw a line against a very forgettable 3-5 fourth place finish for the 10 Ma Meatloaf, she becomes way more appetizing and appealing on paper. My argument with her is, although she has handled wet tracks in the past, you often hear one wet track is different from another. Maybe that had something to do with it. And she is second time this meet here at Gulfstream Park, and that's been a popular, at least, agenda or play of mine since I moved here a little over 3 years ago.
Yeah, you would expect this horse would be likely favored in here. I think 2-1 on the morning line. I did go with the five, as you mentioned. Take Charge Again is stepping up, turning back today, adding blinkers after drawing clear defeat. The pair of next out winners, that was that two lifetime claimer going 3/4 mile. Jane Sabelli, Paco Lopez, named to ride, coming out of that key race. Ma Meatloaf, for all the reasons you mentioned. And then the number two horse in the Palace Two-Step. This one has its claiming tag carved in half and debuts on the main track today. After facing $16,000 types and a pair of 5 furlong sprints on the turf. But what I liked about this horse, you look at the sophomore, run well on a synthetic track. 3 starts, 2 wins in a second. So I'm thinking maybe the main track, this horse can run okay in there. So I put it in second.
Going out for trainer Joe Orsino. His horse is still 5-2 in that first race. I don't think we have a Joe Orsino here in race number 8 on the Wednesday card, but we do have a couple for Mike Maker. We've got another twofer for Safi Joseph Jr. and a major robust size or rematch size looking at a quartet of runners coming out of perhaps the most important last out local race, and that is back or was run back on May the 8th. And different trips, maybe no surprise given a full field or close to a full field on the turf, you just had different trips among the most important runners who were coming out of this race. The one I want, I'm not totally sold on this race, just with the blanket finish, and like I was saying with my late pick five synopsis, there were some new shooters in here that I just prefer a little more. But the horse that I want out of this race is the 4 Dyna Drive, who's about to set sail on the flank of the number 8 Dominate the Moment. He had endured and really slogged through a pretty onerous wide trip around both turns, where you watch the winner in the yellow cap down on the rail, Arithmetic, got a great ride and just slipped through down there beneath Tyler Gaffalione. That was a ride and trip where Tyler made the difference. And if I want anybody out of that race, Ronnie, for me, it's going to be the 8 Dyna Drive. And you clearly agree because you didn't take a horse on top that ran here back on May the 8th.
Yeah, I went with my long shot in here, as I mentioned. I went with Bahamian Prince, who's 12-1 in the morning line, stretching out to the mile, finished second in back-to-back turf sprints going 5 furlongs. But it's trainer Gustavo Delgado. So I just looked up a stat over the last couple of years with Gustavo. Doesn't claim claim that many. But first, after the claim, just all levels, he's 6-for-17, 35%, 59% in the money, and he's got that positive return of investment of $2.18. So here I'm going. I'm going to take a shot in this race. For all the reasons you just shown, I think it's a wide-open affair. I'm going to try and get Bahamian Prince maybe with Gustavo, who I really respect him when he trains horses, especially first off the claim. We'll see how Bahamian Prince runs.
Yeah, we'll see if he stacks up and can he go this distance. That is a concern of mine, but you'll be compensated with the fair price on him. Not really the case, or quite the contrary, with my top pick, the number 6, Uncork the Bottle, who's just down in class, returning off a sharp recent race at Tampa Bay Downs. And the 5, Coco Star, for a first time right off the van at Gulfstream, may have beat an easier field than this, but I have no qualms with his start on May the 7th, and he is just another contender in a race chock full of them towards the tail end of this Wednesday, June the 17th program. There were very few scratches that mattered, per se, today, Ronnie, but I do think the absence or defection of the 2 Create Again in race number 9, which is our last race on the dirt this afternoon, that may open up the door for a horse like my top pick, the 1, Ice Tea, to get loose. This a horse, I'm a little worried. I get both sides of the argument. You left him out, and your opinion of him was he had that big Cinderella run and just has not looked, with some gaps in his races, hasn't in his last 2 looked like the same horse that won here on January 4th. I'd like to think, though, coming in second off a layoff, down for 25,000, with a pace situation or just overall scenario that looks a little easier and a little softer with Create Again not in the race, that Ice-T can find some of that old glory and heart that he had. Because, boy, when he was good for Mary Epler last summer, he was, boy, did he go on a tear.
You make some great points. I think the scratch of the 2 Create Again is really going to help that horse this afternoon. Should have a clear shot. You got Paco in the saddle this afternoon. But I did go with the number 3, who you have in second, Indy Maj, who's turning back to the mile after returning really from an extended layoff.
Yeah, let's show the race, actually, while you talk about the horse. Yes. Yeah, you could take us through, Ronnie. Go ahead.
Finished second, beaten a half length, was 31-1 that afternoon. You didn't know what we were going to get. Beautifully bred 5-year-old son of Tappet for trainer Jeff Engler. You know, we didn't know he's beautifully bred coming off that bench, and he ran okay.
Ran great. I mean, he really ran great. He's got another gray by Unbridled Song about to gear up 4 wide or so, and Blue Buff, who was riding just a wind machine type streak here at Gulfstream Park, and you can watch Blue Buff tighten things up on Indomage, and it seemed to embolden him. It looked like he got nasty and was really trying to hang with Blue Buff in deep stretch. My one question, and I'm curious to see how he runs back, because really that was a solid race. Was it the wet track that moved him up last time?
Well, that's part of the guesswork with any horses that are going from, you know, first off a long, long layup and running exceptionally well. So it's a little bit of a shaky call, but I just was really enamored with that race last time out.
You also have a horse highly rated, in fact, in the second spot. I am very curious to see what we get and overall just maybe the quality. This is going to be a profound test for the 8 Tis Approved. I mean, my goodness, has he gone on a major run. Talk about Blue Buff racking up one win after another. This horse winning his last 3 by about 26 lengths combined.
Yeah, stepping up the competition, going to debut locally after those, as you said, this trio of head swirling victories against cheaper competition up at Tampa. He gets the old class check today with Sammy Camacho in the saddle. I think that he's got to prove he can run with these horses today.
He does. Very high percentage out of town outfit still looking. Darian Rodriguez clearly wins a lot at Tampa. He is a winless in 8 starts here at Gulfstream. 3 of them have hit the board. We'll see if Tis Approved is the first one to bust through for a nice GP maiden win. Race number 10, let's call a final call here as we cap the card with a 3-and-up filly mare, 12-5 to 10-5 claimer. You and I mid-pack the 5, Sydney's Treasure. If all is okay and ready to go off the layoff for Larry Ravelli, could you find a better spot to dip your toe into the local waters here at GP?
And we've been mentioning this about Larry. He really spots his horse as well. Now, this one is Indiana bred, facing maiden special weight competition up there. Now at the 12-5 level, I think he puts it in a good spot. Victor LeBron atop this daughter of Treasure Beach. So we'll see how this horse runs this afternoon.
5-7 for me, 5-3 for Ronnie. You'll have all of us all day afternoon. Keep it locked here to Gulfstream Park, everybody. And without further ado, we send it up to the man, Pete Aiello, for Scratches and Changes.